My guest today is our Sancho Panza, bass baritone Eduardo Chama. Did I get that right
Perfect.
This time?
Perfect.
Good to have you here.
Good to have you.
Thanks for coming. Tell me first of all about Sancho, about this wonderful character. What are the challenges in singing the role?
First of all, I think it's a great human role. It's very human.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very earthy role. And what is challenging, I think vocally, is written beautifully for
this. Is it?
It's beautifully.
So Massenet knew what he was doing with the voice, because we know Massenet is a wonderful orchestrator. You know, he's terrific with instruments, but he's also good for the voice.
It's excellent for the voice. It's one of these operas that you can do 3 shows a day.
Mm.
It's, you feel refreshed after singing the role, and you can do it again. And I believe this is for each role in the opera, also for Don Quixote, and also for Dulcinea and all the other soloists. You feel very, very energetic, and it's a very short opera. I mean, it's 5 acts, but it's 2 hours and something minutes.
So yeah, well, the shortest act is the last act, and it's, what, 11 minutes?
11 minutes, yeah. Yes. It's very short. Now, the challenge vocally is mostly to do with the drama of the story.
Mm-hmm.
I think Sancho goes to a transition from the beginning, and being a very earthy person, and some comedic comments about his mm-hmm. life, to becoming a quasi-hero and an almost a Don Quixote by the end.
Mm-hmm.
Hero in the sense that he is probably the only one in the opera that has the guts to defend Don Quixote in the 4th act when people are laughing at him. I think Dulcinea has a little bit of social pressure.
Yeah.
And that she cannot
That's
really,
an interesting way of
yes,
putting it.
Yes,
yeah.
By her status in his own little town. And Sancho basically doesn't give a damn and just go for it.
Yeah.
And in a way that is very Quixotesque, to put it.
Right.
And the music transforms, because the fourth act, the second act aria is more Leporello-alike.
Mm-hmm.
And the fourth act aria is very Quixote, is very grandiose, if you compare that with the bandit scene, for example, when he sings these beautiful lines. And I think it has that kind of sense when he's describing Quixote as well.
You know, as you're talking, it dawns on me for the first time, I'm sorry, audience, I should have thought of this before and talked to Ferruccio, our Quixote, about it. Massenet calls this a comédie héroïque.
Yes.
A heroic comedy.
Comedy.
What do you feel that means to the role of the story?
It's exactly that. It has a lighter side, obviously, from the beginning. Even Quichotte is funny.
Right.
With all his comments. Yeah. Yes, in the duel of the first act. Excuse me, I need to write a nice line, then I kill you.
Yeah.
Yes. So it's a comedy which has a tragic ending, and it has a tragic development. It's not only the ending.
It begins light and then ends quite seriously.
Serious.
Yeah.
But it's heroic on the sense of that the adventures of Don Quixote, these fights against the windmills, against the goats, against these adventures, has really a purpose, that we see it at the end.
Mm.
It's not only these monsters he sees. I think these are metaphors from what we fight, you know, daily to save morals, to save love, to save humanity. And I think people start seeing that it's not that crazy to fight against windmills.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that crazy, you know, to see things that are not there.
Yeah.
When you wanna, you know, save certain things in that you think they are your principles of life. And in that sense, I think it's heroic.
Yeah. Ever since we did it 5 years ago, I've had a very soft spot in my heart for this opera. But it's not well known at all. It's not done very often. Why is that?
I think it had a renaissance lately, maybe because people like Ferruccio, Sam Raimi, you know, even José Van Damme, they brought her to the attention of opera companies again and again and again.
But why did it disappear after Chayapin died?
That's who knows.
Because there were lots of bases.
Yes,
well, maybe not
maybe
lots.
Not, but who knows? Who knows what are the reasons? There are certain operas that they are very costly to produce. This is not one of them.
No, not at all.
You know, so people can say it's the economics. No. There are many operas that are very, because of the high quality of the singing, like Don Carlo, for example, it's very tough to find, you know, five, six
the
singers
right
that you can
cast.
do it.
Yeah.
This is beautiful singing, but you can find. I think it's mostly because it's one of the things that people forget about, and it's terrible that they do.
Yeah.
Because we stick in the opera companies with Bohème, Nozze di Figaro, you know, et cetera, et cetera.
So it might be that it's just a hard sell. It's, you know, I think just even the story, the novel, the myth of Don Quixote is not up front and center in people's minds anymore, whereas 50, 60 years ago it might have been more.
I tell you the truth, I know for a fact that there are an incredible amount of operas that are gorgeous. I had the pleasure to do this opera in Central City. It's called Les Jongleurs de Notre Dame.
Oh, yes.
That nobody knows.
Of Massenet.
Of Massenet.
And actually, that was one of the five operas that he did for Monte Carlo, along with Don Quixote. And it's a gorgeous piece,
it's
isn't it?
It's a gorgeous piece. A lot of male, because it's in a monastery, so there are a lot of priests. And the music is gorgeous. It's beautiful. And the story, I mean, and we did there, and I never heard them.
Never heard of it again.
Yes, again. Yeah. And I think there are two things that are going on right now in the opera in the world. One is the renaissance of taking these operas that there are known but not so well known like others, and revamping, rebringing them to the stage. And the other thing, and especially in the States, is all these new composers doing operas. You know, Robert Aldrich with Elmer Gantry, Dead Man Walking, Silent Night, which I saw, and it's a gorgeous.
I hear that spectacular.
I mean, there are so many composers, Aina Damar by Osvaldo Golijova,
who are beginning to write operas for people to listen to.
Yes.
That approachable music.
Totally.
You know, that where, oh, there's a tune. Yes. Oh, there's a gorgeous melody. Oh, there's some beautiful lyricism. I mean, you can't, obviously, I love things as dissonant as Wozzeck. You know, I mean, it's a great, great opera. Yeah. But you also have to have the lyric, don't you?
It has to have a reason why it's dissonant. It has to have a reason why it's melodic. Drama and music go, you know, together.
Yeah.
And when it's not, when it's just because it's an experiment, then it ends as an experiment.
Yeah, and it's not going to work.
Yeah.
It's not going to go anywhere. What's next for you? Where are you going from here?
Well, there are some proposals, but there is no nothing signed yet.
But you're teaching.
I'm teaching. I'm teaching at Rutgers University, and that's my other love.
Your base right now.
Yes, I have the two labs, performing and teaching, and it's very satisfying. And I'm the co-director of the Opera Institute at Rutgers. So we have a program, a master's, and an artist diploma just in opera performance.
Oh, wonderful.
So it's all the courses are into that. But and also I teach at the Castleton Festival with Laurie Mazel every Sunday.
Oh, marvelous.
So this is...
Well, you're busy then.
I'm busy.
Okay,
yes,
good.
I'm very busy.
I'm so glad you're busy. Thank you so much for
you're
being
welcome.
With us. And have a wonderful performance.
And come to see the opera.
They will.